Yeah, I didn't go New World for any of these.
Okay.
What I'm gonna do through this tasting is reveal myself to be an idiot. Because like I just want with rosé.
Wish that's been a mystery for all.
Yeah, no one's had any idea up to this point that I don't know what I was talking about.
Welcome back to another edition of Blind Wine Tasting. Once again, we have three wines for us to guess how good we think they are, what they are, and how much we'd actually pay for them. Really, this is just assessing the quality of these three wines. We're also having the game of actually trying to figure out what they are. And these wines, as always, are provided to us by our good friends at Different Drop. If you want to try any of these wines, jump in the description below, head to the website. There is a specific channel for Wine for the People wines. If you chuck in the discount code WFTP, you'll get a lovely little discount code on all of these wines. It helps the show, it helps Different Drop, helps you get wine. So without any more mucking around, let's get into it. We do have three wines in front of us here. All appear to be rosés, but our goal here is to identify the correct country for the correct rosé. In my experience of blind tasting wine and tasting wine in general, that's really difficult to do. So this will be a really good fun challenge for us. So let's enjoy us really mucking this one up.
Wine number one. This is probably the pinkest of the three, comparing them side by side.
Very salmon hued, very cherry. Not too much on the nose, bit of like grass, bit of strawberry, as will probably be a common tasting note across all three. And a nice like kind of more ripe cherry, more like cranberry style flavor and rhubarb as well.
It's yummy, solid rosé. Yeah, it's really pretty, good winemaking, really nice and clean. I would probably take three bottles. And I reckon this is probably maybe $25.
Off the bat, Italy. Italian. It's got this sort of like old world thing to it where it's not like, some rosés these days will be like, oh, you want to have fun in the sun? You want to hang out with your friends and wear a cap backwards? Sick, we got the wine for you. This wine laughs at those wines. It goes, what are you children doing? This is how you make wine. It tastes old world in that sense. And I only know so many countries from the old world, so Italy is where I'm going with this one.
What a fun food match. Yeah, like this would be great fun with food. Not just because of the color, but for salmon, definitely structural. So gut feeling is Italy here, but look, I have no idea.
Then we got wine number two. Oh, this is a bit more savory. It's got a bit of reduction.
Getting into our more pale pink sort of rosé territory here with the next couple. I do love swishing rosé around a glass. Reminds me of better times.
Stinky, very stinky. This is reductive as hell. Yeah, unfortunately, I think for this wine there, it's more reductive and savory than anything else.
Yeah, actually quite mouth-watering. But the reduction on the nose kind of makes me think it's probably an old world style of rosé in terms of variety. It's quite light. I think, yeah, the nose, it just needs a little bit of time to blow off. But behind that, there's some really good wine.
It's a little bit flat. I don't know, I can't put my finger on it, but it reminds me of IKEA for some reason. Like the food court at IKEA is just like the vibe that I get from it. I don't know if Sweden's a big rosé producing nation.
I'm gonna say that wine number two is French. And I would take three bottles, but I think, yeah, it's probably a little bit more than wine number one, so maybe three bottles at $40.
Number three, very similar color to the last, maybe a halfway house between this one and the second one and the first one.
This is from Australia. Aussie, and I say that because I think these two are old world and I think this is new world, and I think that this is targeting exactly what I'm talking about, which is that like fruity yums in the sun.
Actually smells quite sweet, almost caramelized. Yeah, that nose is throwing me a little bit. I've never seen that character in a rosé before. It's really interesting. Honestly, the first thing that springs to mind when I taste it is like toffee apple.
There's a lot of tannin here. There is a lot of tannin here. That's really interesting. I'm still gonna go France. I reckon these are all old world. I'm gonna go another three.
Yep, pick of the bunch. Give us six. It's still not my favorite rosé. It does have this slightly, I wanna say fishy, but fishy isn't the right word, but like the same sort of experience that you have after eating a little bit of seafood where it's sort of like this lingering flavor where you're like, oh yeah, I'm conscious of the fact that I've just eaten something that came out of the ocean. Maybe it's salt. Maybe it's got a bit of salinity to it.
It doesn't taste old worldy. I would have to say Australian for this one as well on wine number three. And I would take just a couple of bottles and it's probably about $32.
Favorite one's probably gonna be the first one, but this is a close second. But overall, look, rosé is a really challenging wine to judge in this kind of context. Guys at Different Drop has definitely given us a bit of a hard ask. But with that being said, really good fun. So I'm hoping I'm getting in that country demo here, because this is tough. This is really, really tough. I thought the last week was tough. This is way more tough. I'm really interested to see what Henry and Laura think. Three rosés to guess which country they were made, which in wine spheres is just a cruel thing to do. So to everyone at Different Drop, we love you, but right now I'm not a big fan.
No, I'm not big on Different Drop currently.
No, what did we think of the range of wines overall?
Overall, yeah, good. Good for rosé.
Yeah, good for rosé, I guess. Like, good for you, rosé. Yeah. You've made some wines.
The enthusiasm is just seeping out of the walls here.
I liked one of these wines a lot, and the other two I was like, oh, okay, whatever, you exist.
The most compelling part about this was the actual intellectual challenge to determine what country they were from. So let's just get into that. So wine number one, what was the gut instinct of country?
I said Australian.
I said Italian.
I said Italian too.
Ooh.
Yeah, I didn't go New World for any of these.
Okay.
What I'm gonna do through this tasting is reveal myself to be an idiot. Because like, I just want, with rosé.
Which that's been a mystery for all.
Yeah, no one's had any idea up to this point that I don't know what I was talking about. But for me with rosé, I want it to be like just simple, juicy, sweet. And like, for me, that wine's not what I'm looking for in a rosé. Like that's,
okay.
It's a more interesting wine than a lot of the rosés that I've had, but all of those boring rosés over here are more things I'd want to drink.
I actually really loved it.
Yeah, this is my favorite out of the three.
Like if I order a glass of rosé, that's exactly what I want.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, because it's refreshing. It's got that lift of fruit. It's not overripe, and I think sometimes that's what can happen with rosé is you end up with these kind of heavy fruits.
So Lockie, what is it? Wow, okay, $22.
I said 42. I figured it was going to cost.
Yeah, I was.
Toscana.
$30. Toscana. Gigi Rosato.
Ooh.
There's a lot of Italian-looking words on the front
Italian.
Of that.
Italian!
Let's go!
Bang, here we go. So it's Tuscan rosé. So I would assume this is a Sangiovese. Which outside of Grenache is probably one of the more, particularly in Australia, is one of the more varieties commonly used for rosé. So unfined, unfiltered. That's why it's got that extra colour. I'd be assuming these ones have definitely been well filtered.
Yeah, look at the, when you tip it over, look at the sediment forming on the bottom there. Yeah,
bitsy. How good. But it's still really good fun. Really good fun. And again, $22, Italian rosé. Yeah, just get it. Wine number two. Yeah, this one was my least favorite. What did you
interested to know why it's your least favorite.
Oh, I think you know why it's my least favorite. Why, and why is that, Laura?
Is it the reduction?
That's exactly right.
Yeah, it's
stinky.
I tried to be nice about it. There was, obvious reduction and some...
I think it smells like pickled corn.
Maximum $30.
Yeah, but I thought it was French. I thought this was a French rosé that was worth $28 and I'll have a singular bottle of it.
Where'd you
get? Yeah, I said French as well. I actually went to $40.
Ooh, ritzy rosé. I went Spain.
How much was it? 32?
Okay, there we go. So above 30, but under, put in that 40 bracket. It is Australian. It is Nebbiolo Rosé from Beechworth, which is really cool. These guys are a meeting of minds. For me, the reduction is not what I'm particularly looking for.
Yeah, what I said when I was drinking these is, these first two, I have no need for in my life, but I bet you Laura and Noah find some things in there that are really interesting, and you really like this one, you quite like the first one. It's not the rosé that I want. I want this fruity yum shit, and that's not it to me.
Well then, let's get on to wine number three.
Fruity yums, let's go.
There we go, we figured it out. We got there towards the end. Yeah, definitely my second favorite, for sure. This was more provincial to me. I called this one France. Because it was just generally, it was more atypical rosé. It was straight up and down, just like what I generally expect from the style. So I was like, well, I don't think it's Australian because there is a bit of interest here. So gun and pictures.
Shots at us. Just a drive-by on the Australian rosé industry.
It had this kind of caramel nose.
Like a caramel apple thing.
Yeah, it was really cool.
Yeah, that's actually a really good shout. That's a really good point. That's a very good note.
I mean, it's no pickled corn, but it's quite good. Nice enough.
Nothing's like a pickled corn, my friend.
You haven't lived.
Lucky.
Oh my goodness, it's got to be French. Chateau.
Bandol. It is Provence.
So if we were going to drink a rosé from France, this is where it would be from.
Yeah, pretty much. And an appellated rosé, not just, Provence is appellated, but this is like more hyper-specific. And I believe it... Is it Matara? Is it Mavird? I think so, yeah. I think that is the appellation requirement for the variety. So it's not Grenache, it's actually Mourvèdre, or Mataro, as we call it in Australia.
As we do.
But I mean, look, $72 for a rosé is a big ask. But that being said, this is a specific place and a specific variety. It is showcasing the region. So there is something to be said about that. And it's also biodynamically farmed. So wine of the week.
I mean, like, for me, it's this one.
But Laura?
$72 though, like I wouldn't pay $72 for a rosé.
Yeah, that's the thing, it's the price point. But yeah, in terms of quality, I would have to go with the last one as well.
Well, I think that's decided then. I think where democracy leads the last one. So if you want to like lux out on your rosé,
yeah,
this is a very luxurious rosé.
I don't know. So Italy, Australia, France.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Almost, I was so close.
I was 66% of the way there.
I was 33% of the way there.
Yeah, I'll take the win there. Thank you very much, Laura, for joining us over the last few weeks. It's been fantastic to have you.
It's been a real treat.
And we'll see you guys again next week.
See ya.